there really isn't any better way to sort of bring today together, in my opinion, than with Professor Patricia MacCormack, who I first met, I think, almost 10 years ago at Treadwell's. And for those of you who don't know me, I'm Christine Oakley Harrington from Treadwell's, and I met Patricia, yes. And I'm still recovering 10 years on. And a word entered my vocabulary that day, which has never left me, and that is the word mucosal. And if that doesn't mean anything to you now, I promise you in an hour's time it will. So our speaker, Professor Patricia MacCormack, is a professor of continental philosophy. She is an internationally recognized scholar in her field. She works on posthuman ethics, and her books are four, including Cinesexuality, which is on sale in all fine bookstalls, including the one at this shop at this conference. And her most recent work is, I'm going to read it out because I'll get it wrong if I don't, The Animal Catalyst Towards a Human Theory, which came out in 2014. And it's a pleasure to introduce her because she's a bit, in my opinion, in my experience, a bit of a life-changing experience. So, Patricia, thank you very much.
No pressure there. Well, thank you for asking me. Thank you, Christina, for that incredibly terrifying introduction. I should actually thank Christina because she helped me come out of the closet as a practitioner, because when I was doing academia as a youngster, you didn't talk about the M word, and you certainly didn't talk about it if you were interested in things to do with tentacles and physics and chaos. And now I just tell my department they can fuck off because I'm a magician. So. So, the best part about this also is I get to cut half of the paper because I don't have to explain to all of you what most of the terms mean. However, I will warn you, it's philosophically dry, so get ready. But there are loads of pictures. And also, I'm a bit of a text whore. I love text. It's really nice to have seen the spare panel just before this panel because I love the interaction of text. So I'm going to show slides while I speak, but these slides are so you can zone in and out of what I'm saying if you get bored. They're not meant to be exemplifying, and the text will not always match up with the text that I'm reading, so please feel free to enter your own trans state during my vile ochre accent assault upon you. And the best part is I'm starting with everybody's favourite OOO hero, Lovecraft. So this paper is premised on an alchemical marriage, both participants of which would probably destroy me if they found out that I had married them. So this paper takes the fantasy of Lovecraft and connects it with feminist art dreamings, and I say dreamings because I'm not using it representationally, of monsters, and I'm going to be primarily using Irigaray. Now, she doesn't even like being called a feminist, so imagine if she like found out she was getting Lovecrafted. So the paper comes from the cephalopodic inspirations of Lovecraftian gods and monsters, but also it has to do with post-thelemic working with demons, and also my interest in Enochian magic in the Book of Enoch, and angels, and the Elohim and the Nephilim. So I'm going to ask you to see those words as relatively interchangeable, and hopefully their interchangeability will become clear. I'm not asking you to homogenise them, but their manifestation is a philosophical particularity. But also because Lovecraftian gods and monsters are becoming increasingly popular, but against, so I'm offering a Lovecraftian reading that is against the phallocentric nihilism and the trend for new object-oriented ontology, realism, exit Graham Harman, which leaves behind sexuate and ecosophical ethics. Now, I am aware I wrote this paper before Donna Haraway's new book was announced, but it's not out yet, so technically I'm not, you know, I'm still doing something new. Lovecraft's people are fish, flesh, foul face to begin with. They gaze fishily, ultimately collapsing their flesh into the animal, vegetal, mineral body. In Through the Gates, he describes them as human and non-human, vertebrate and invertebrate, conscious and mindless, animal and vegetable. And this collapses And this collapse creates an intimate relation with the earth, with all cells and molecules, so that connectivity to the unlike is what defines Lovecraftian entities, both protagonists and monster gods. In The Nameless City, he states, "More often, nothing of which either the naturalist or the paleontologist ever heard, but strangest of all were their heads, which presented a contour violating all known biological principles. I thought of comparisons as varied as the cat, the bulldog, the mythic satyr, and the human being," end quote. And of course, the connections with Spare couldn't be more palpable after that brilliant presentation. So these heads, but they're not faces, are probing satellites, and they do not replace the human. They include the human in the Earth's own pantheon, while also including the domestic animal, the mythical, as part of the real. So Lovecraft's dichotomies themselves know no taxonomy. Materiality, animality, life and reality are part of the vast connective tissue collapsing all thought, and by doing so, opening it out into the infinity, the very antithesis of the homogeneity human knowledge perpetuates by converting all elements to being defined and evaluated through their relation with the human subject. In this way, Lovecraft refutes contemporary media trends, not because he stands for a nostalgic vision, but because he is a vision of a futurity found in an immemorial past where time has collapsed along with particles of difference to create a liberation of cosmos that is both imminent and available. In this sense, Lovecrafts are not other worlds, but opportunities to access dissipations of this world without each story as a unique trajectory leading back to a vacuous, empty repetition of stagnant, homogenous trends, such as those which structure the marketability of literature of all genres based on variety of forms, which ultimately end up being the same signifying compulsions, just dressed differently, thus refuting real difference for itself. In his book on Spinoza, Deleuze explicates ethics through the concept of common notions. And this is a quote from Deleuze's book on Spinoza. "In short, a common notion is the representation of a composition between two or more bodies and a unity of this composition. For when we encounter a body that agrees with ours, we experience an affect or feeling of joy, passion, although we do not adequately know what it has in common with us." End quote. So common notions do not mean ways we are the same, and this is absolutely crucial, but that each element or entity or thing does not come to the relation already fixed in their qualities, which will therefore either match with or go against the other. So difference is actually commonality in this sense. And as we've all understood from magical workings and from love and desire themselves, it is the commonality of not knowing what you have in common that makes one's frisson in creative affects potentialized. Experiencing joy comes from an encounter, even when we do not or cannot know the commonality from which the affects arise. Things that are unlike us, that explode rather than confirm who we are. So in ethics, commonality can be interpreted as the openness of each and any element to experiencing the other. Spinoza's ethics are defined by something's capacity for being affected. One thing that is defined by what it doesn't have in common with the human is the monster. The monster is fluid, hybrid, metamorphic, and so the monster is one of my ways out of the Anthropocene. By virtue of openness to the alterity of the other, commonality is reduced to the majestic but simple notion of openness itself. Encounters are not conditional based on preconceived definitions of the other to which one comes. Openness is arriving at an experience of an idea or an artwork that we do not presume in advance, so we cannot presume our reaction, so we can no longer presume we know ourselves, so we ourselves are rethought. And I think that for ritual magic, this is absolutely crucial if you're not doing results-based. Encounters with the preconceived is no encounter, but a confirmation of self. When we don't like something, it is the we, not the thing, that we should be at question. Desire is neither dialectic nor reiterative of self and other. It is an event upon which we can only reflect fleetingly and which cannot be repeated nor predicted. Ethical desire cannot operate in the positioning of two entities aware of themselves as closed subjects. Heterosexuality, heterosociality, commonality as complementarity, and homosexuality, homosociality, sameness as repetition, privilege positions over intensities. Fluid, formless sexuality is queer sexuality. It is feminist desire. It is monstrous desire. It is mucosal desire. In terms of reflections on specific entities whose capacity to affect have been oppressed through signifying systems, the monster stands as iconic and the woman as having her sexuality made complementary to men. The monster describes many things while itself not being specifically defined as anything except not normal. Just as female sexuality has been defined as anything that is utilitarian in phallologocentric sexuality. The monster is wonder and horror. It's the limit of humanity and proof that the human always exceeds the parameters of what we think it is capable of. We are all monsters. The monster crosses species, boundaries. It is hybrid, metamorphic, but it is not properly a thing that is so much as something which fails to be something else, that is, the normal human. What kind of queer relations could a monstrous configuration lead us through monstrosity? So Randolph Carter is an example I like to use. Carter's existence as forms over subjects fulfills these cosmogenic criteria. And this is a quote. Carters of forms, both human and non-human, vertebrate and invertebrate, conscious and mindless animal and vegetable, and more. There were carters having nothing in common with earthly life. So I love the way that Lovecraft is able to collapse the materiality of Earth, but also talk about becoming imperceptibility as a kind of fractal expression of the world. This final phase descriptions, the final phase of the description of Carter elucidates that there is no more resonance in Lovecraft. Resonances with the human disappear, meaning knowledge constituted through orders of human perception is defunct. Resonances with the human are always haunted by resonances with things unnameable. And so the very promise of reassurance through resonance becomes perilous. The exhaustive postmodern circus of contemporary media overrepresentation, freak after freak, transgressive after transgressive, is encyclopedic. It utilises such spectacles, be they cinematic, literary, or increasingly real life, in order to fulfil the vacuous promise that by representing, one can objectify, apprehend, and know, so become safe from any aberration. Lovecraft's horrors are found in their intimacy, to which their protagonists cannot stand in opposition. The frequent revelation in much of Lovecraft's work is that the monster is the self, found most profoundly perhaps in The Outsider. The monster is me means that Lovecraft's tales are not so much populated by monsters, and therefore you don't get the whole vanquishment narrative. Rather, protagonists and readers become part of a new territory altogether, which is why in so many tales, the very terrain itself is integral to the hybrid, strange genealogies, be it the farmlands of the wards, the subterranea of Innersmouth, or the infinite cosmos of the ancient ones. And we are inextricable from the territory, connected as parts of a singular living infinite. This is how Lovecraft differs from both traditional horror, where the monster is in our world, or fantasy, where a constructed world is stalked by monsters who belong. Lovecraft collapses the alien and the terrestrial, just as he collapses dream and reality, flesh and earth, space and the within and without. So to his strange bedfellow. French feminist philosopher Luce Rigoret offers the concept of mucus to explore relations of difference, which meld flesh as liquid, sticky, inflecting materiality. She states, and I quote, "In order to bring about sexual difference as ethics, however, we must constitute a space that could be inhabited by each sex, body or flesh. That threshold which has never been examined in itself, the female sex, it is a threshold unto mucosity. Beyond the classical opposites of love and hate, liquid and ice, there perpetually lies a half-open threshold," end quote. Mucus is the luminal, the in-between, the sticky, the space within, the threshold. It is the moment of a Spinozan ethics because it is the commonality that makes us inextricable from the other. The monstrosity of female desire in fictional and historical discourse on monsters, the sticky oozing materiality of the collapse between monsters and women in film and literature, and historically, the horror of vulvic female sexuality is viscous connectivity, it is animal, it is hysterical. Irigaray's refusal of the binarization of love and hate reminds us of the doubling of fear and wonder the monster elicits, as well as queer theory seeking the beyond of hetero and homo. And it's also how I've always read the neither neither, because it's against binaries, but it's also against the isomorphism of binaries actually not being binaries, but being a dominant and a failure to fulfill those dominant ideologies. Monstrous femininity and female monstrosity in art can open up new configurations of desire, but I think ritual is a form of art, and I think art is a form of ritual practice. Additionally, an ethics of monstrosity will celebrate the potentialities of future experiments in flesh and subject. Art as ritual has a... And when I say art, I'm also including, and this is actually what Cinesexuality is about, I think there's a ritual in being a spectator and there's a ritual in encountering art as well. So it's not simply about creating art, but it's about the creativity that the affect of art and one's openness to that affect creates in the self. So art as ritual has a particular strength in this project as it deals with fabulation, extending and tautening the very limits of the possible in audaciously representing the impossible. It is our relationship with art which must alter, not the art itself, which is the irrefutable and irresistible mucus of art. An almost unbearable contract of desire. Monsters as glimpses of the already gone and never arrived form. The inhuman refers not to the non-human, but that which is excessive as human within us all. Through experiences of pleasure as despotic encounters with inhuman entities, the inhuman subject experiences the mucosal expression of inhuman ecstasy. The breakdown between subject and object, other and same, is desire, according to Irigaray, which, and I quote, cannot be equated with that of the masculine world as a result of the way it lives in mucus, end quote. So the relation between the fascinated and the event monster constitutes a mucosal life. Monstrous desire is the driving force of the ways in which subjectivity unfolds and refolds, shifting paradigms as self, as metamorphic, always and in spite of itself, launching upon new becomings. Women have long been the objects of monster studies, of scientific, psychoanalytic and philosophical treatises. Women do not own their monstrosity. It emerges through an isomorphic logic of science on the one side and the religious right on the other. If women's sexuality is monstrous for its failure to be equivalent to fellow logocentrism, then should women's sexuality be thought, it would be thought, with difference not constituted as a heterocentric discourse of lack and phallus, but of an undifferentiated monstrous merging. That's why I really like her model of the two lips, which is both the doubling of the labial lips, but also the idea that when we speak with lips, and if you have two lips, you have a discourse that is... bidirectional and therefore univocal rather than this monodirectional fellow normativity. And this is also true for encounters with both ritual practice that look for results and with encounters with art, because if you're having a monodirectional dialogue with the artwork, then you're not living in the mucus of the affectivity of ritual or art. Women's sexuality may be monstrous, but here the monstrous lover is that which catalyses thought, pleasure and fluid mystic carnality. And so I see this not even necessarily in another person, but in all forms of art, including ritual as art. Monstrous sex is neither reproductive in the actual or the performative virtual sense and is not located in one spatial configuration. No dialectic exists, so creation is necessary and inevitable. Production over reproduction. And by reproduction, I don't mean having babies, but I mean the reproductivity of a reperformativity over heteronormativity. Monstrous sex has no genesis or expiation, but is fluid spatially and temporally. Nothing lacks, so no fulfillment is required. So I'm going to show you some pretty pictures now. Some examples of monstrous sex can be offered here. Resisting the more traditional mammalian anthro-bestiality of Beauty and the Beast. So even though I've chosen the wonderful La Belle et la Bête, it's still very mammalian. It's a bit Donna Haraway for me, you know, it's like a companion animal. I have traced a particular trajectory from Hooker size, and I'm terrible at writing, so if you want to know what these slides are, you just ask me, but I don't write things because I'm really bad at PowerPoint. So this is the diver and the octopus. So in Japanese erotic art, the expression of female genitalia, far from being lack or smoothed over, as we would see in Greco-Roman sculpture, is made resonant with the beak of the octopus. So we have these beautiful common notions, this very Spinozan ethics of cunnilingus between an octopus beak and a very vulvic, a very labial vulva. So it's an eternal doubling, a proliferative ellipsis, a unique sympathetic genus of desiring organ unto itself, belonging not to one gender of the human, but creating an inhuman body without organs between two mucosal monstrosities. A homogenitalic but heteroaffective in the most extreme manner. The cephalopod, which is already an interstitial genus, neither fish nor mammal, reproducing from the head. But here we do not see another species as such, because this is not an octopus. This is an abstract animal, or what Deleuze and Guattari would call a fabulated animal. It is what the dreaming of the magi and what art can offer us, which is without fetishizing or co-opting an actual other, we can create these new fabulations that are animal, vegetable, cosmic, multigendered. It is a proliferated creation that is no less effective for being so, because if we can imagine it, we can see it. By repudiating phallic intervention, the woman herself is no longer a woman within a human isomorphic dichotomy. And this is also, well, it's got text in it as well, as I've already told you about my text image fetish. But it's also an underwater any space whatever. How are they breathing? We've all heard men say that before. How do you breathe if you do that for that long? It is impossible fabulation. Sorry, that was a bit low, wasn't it? Monstrous desire, mucosal, and its great power is the mucosal energy with which it pulls us in as complicit, fascinated witnesses, part of the art event, but unable to defer this event to pre-organised territories of desire and pleasure. What, I hear you ask, would be a pre-organised territory of cephalopod sex? Well, much as I love Picasso, he fails. Picasso loved Hokusai and he loved The Dream of the Fisherman's Wife, and so he did a really crap job at trying to do a homage. So, Picasso was deeply influenced by the octopus pictures of Hokusai. However, we see here he has not been able to resist the phallic pull of the configuration. His is a voyeuristic schema where we witness, but repetition and recognition colonise the peculiarity and singularity of the original. It's like, really? And also, it's a squid. It's not even a fucking octopus. But anyway, enough dissing Picasso. Let's go on to some fluorescent vegetal sex. And I know someone's giving a paper on Zolofsky tomorrow, so that's very exciting. But this is a still from Andrei Zolofsky's Possession, where Isabella Gianni doesn't like her boyfriend because he's really annoying and a bit of a mansplainer, and she doesn't like her husband because he's a whiny little brat. And so instead she gets pregnant and just by herself. And then she has a miscarriage in the tube station, and then she carries the junk to an apartment and puts it on the bed. And lo and behold, if you do that, apparently it grows into whatever you want. And it starts very vegetal. So this is the vegetal sort of beginning bit. But as you can see, it becomes quite cephalopodic quite early. And I really love this because the tentacles are at the head rather than at the bottom. So it's quite a heteronormative image. You know, tentacle, weird creature that she kind of made up on her own is on top of her. And they seem to be having a nice time. But it's also like you're watching it and thinking, what the fuck is that? That doesn't have any, you know, and if the head is the side of Logos, then of course the tentacles coming out of the head makes all problems, because if it's multi, then is it still phallic or is it not? And so the amount of questions that this brings. But also, as you can see, it's very mucosal. And the whole point is she picks up a bundle of mucus that comes out of her and takes it home and grows a lover, because the men she's with are a bit rubbish. So, you know, talk about taking it literally. I've already said it's fabulation, but, you know. Anyway, so it leads to the question, first of all, it leads to the question, what is she doing with it? But also then it leads to the other question, what is this sexuality? If it is such a queer relation with unlike entities, are we still talking about a woman or a human? And what happens when you have these common notions of the absolutely other, the absolutely uncommon? What does this do? And so in this way, it's an incredible trans state, because not only does it ask the questions, but it gets rid of the need for the questions. The question becomes, why do you need to know? What are you going to do with the knowledge of knowing? And this is incredibly important. So more correctly, we should be asking, what is the becoming of these two, or this one, or this proliferation? Because we're also losing, in their merging, the idea of the two and the one. And so even the concept of unity, multiplicity, vulvic proliferation is present here. Our questions offer a choice between revolutionary inaudible answers that enter us into this mucosal inflection. To answer, even with a refusal to answer, is to close off. This encounter is emphatically sexual, as you can see, but entirely extricated from any hetero or even perverse paradigms. She's not going to have a box to tick on the what is your sexuality form, unless it's like, prefer not to say. Also, and I know this sounds really vacuous, but she's happy. She's really happy with this thing. It's like female sexuality itself. It's unformed, it's incomplete, it's unpredictable, but it is nonetheless desirable for what it can do that is not laid out in pre-established sexual acts or paradigms. It is an actual materialization of female desire as not repressed, but that which has not yet been acknowledged outside masculine paradigms. But I'm also simultaneously saying I don't want it to be acknowledged, because to know it is to reify it, is to constitutionalize it, and we don't want that either. So like female sexuality, the creature is sticky, amorphous, and monstrous. However, it's not like the alien maternal head that is the complete fulfillment of every concept of abjection, which is mothers are leaky and sticky and gross and women are leaky and sticky and gross, but then they're dry and that's even worse. So, you know, this is a much more phallic kind of tentacled creature. But it continues to develop. Let's go back to her and her friend.
She's happy.
Yeah, she's happy. And it continues to develop without quickening. This is the thing. It keeps going. It keeps changing. It's like, what next? Imagine how long relationships would last if you just never knew what you were coming home to. That would be great. I mean, I don't mean like mentally. I mean physically. The prevalence of the visual, the solid, the demarcated, the relegated, the known, the fantasy of objectivity, even the questions itself, ablate and atrophy, fluidity, connectivity, accountable subjectivity, thought, the multisensorial, and speech which is not through the language of the same or the one. So these are symbolic resonances between the monster and female sexuality. Leaky, unbound, revolting, whatever that means. Unpredictable, dangerous, fascinating, multiple, a world to be studied but never apprehended, potential, and also a threat to existing sexual narratives. Are they all drinking wine? Because I'm really jealous if they're all drinking wine. But also, it's the threat of what Deleuze and Guattari called interkingdoms or meshed worlds themselves, which is raised. And Deleuze and Guattari call these unnatural participations. And what I like about this... So I hope you got to read the Origaro quote, because I didn't. But unnatural participations, Deleuze and Guattari call, they're not unnatural as in, you know, it's unnatural, it's disgusting, but what they are talking about is that human discourse and modes of signification and subjectification are not able to accept the diversity and versatility of life, whatever that means, and therefore nature is always too much, and this can be the most basic, you know, the wonderful amoebas in Spare. But so when they say unnatural, what they mean is that nature is, for humans, unnatural. So actually there's an ecosophical and a cosmic ethics here. So when I say unnatural participations, I don't mean unnatural in that very derogatory way. I mean it in a sort of infinite way, so a cosmic way.
Could possibly Marco Pozzi and Robert Answer have a quiet word with the folks outside? Thank you.
Are they all the way outside?
No, they're just not outside enough.
I bet they're at your store. So here are a couple, three examples. The first one is Ishtar by the Belgian artist Bernard Knopf. From 1888, so we could already see that, you know, tentacle sex never went out of fashion. And then in the middle, of course, we have one of Brian Ward's beautiful illustrations. And you notice that as the Liebenal and Psychonaut become more complex, his work goes from being quite... So the early Cthulhus are quite seminal. They look a little bit like sperm, and then some of them are quite phallic. But they, the further they go, they start to splay out and they become incredibly abstract and vulvic. And I really like watching that trajectory. I'm sure Peter Carroll didn't get it because he would just be like, oh, my God, I'm not having that in my book. But I think that they become incredibly vulvic the further abstracted they go. So the more, you know, the more one is immersing oneself into chaos magic and losing the self in order to become otherwise or become cosmic, the more doubled and the more Rorschach and the more abstract and the more vulvic the images come. And then this is from a contemporary artist, Jeff Conway, and his company, Pushing Normal. And what I like about that is, because tentacle sex is really trendy now. It's, it's in. But what I really like about this picture...
That's the third one across, right?
Yeah, the third one across, is that I don't know if the octopus is eating her head or if it is her head, but I also like sort of, and I'm not a prude, but I like that the octopus is giving her a bit of a modesty panel because a lot of the, you can call it erotica, I call it infantile, but is, you know, like, oh, look, octopus and nude lady. But this is, you know, I think that this looks to me like a minotaur or a satyr or something where you're not quite sure, does the head belong? Is the head being worn? Is the head eating the body, you know? So I really like that ambiguity. I think that shows this wonderful proliferation of relationality where the two are not extricable. The skin, the texture and the threat of monsters are constituted as scaly, slimy, infective, bacterial, blood-sucking and ultimately is the choice of the spectator as to whether they will enter into creative relations with these monsters or reify traditional lines of dominance by slaughtering the monster... because the monster is the unconditional unknown. This relation is one of love because there are no conditions, no way to describe or satisfy the relation, the encounter or the events. They are painful yet beautiful, invisible yet perceptible and unqualified in the same way as thought is independent of knowledge and a failure of truth, but no less affective and materially so and no less wondrous. So like monsters, women are not things but continuities. With these monsters, we see only in half light, but it's always enough in that it is tactile and viscous. And what I really like about the cephalopodic monsters is they are incredibly tactile and viscous in a way that is not so much with the mammalian monsters because you kind of just want to rub their fuzzy bellies. But so these monsters tease and exploit the viscosity of the eye itself as seeing beyond its capacity for recognition, making the visual a protean fleshly matter without form, and the image as the canvas, stone or screen itself a mucosal skein. So now I'm going to talk about angels as a kind of monster because they're not religious angels, although I am going to show you some religious pictures. And when I say angel, I'm... absolutely hijacking a rigorous use of the word angel. However, my angels are more Nietzschean in their kind of demonic angels, so I'm also going to invoke a bit more Enoch. Beyond the apprehension of the arboreal structure that places man at their zenith, an animal, monster, vegetal or otherwise, within a strict hierarchy, Lovecraft's rhizomatic series of infinite connectivities mean all matter itself is alterity, unique in its specific proximities to other elements and within itself. For this reason, inclusion of minorities positively would not redeem readings of his work because we all hate Lovecraft because he was a racist misogynist. However, if he had have included women and not been racist, it still wouldn't have helped. Because his work, and this is the good thing about him, is premised on the refusal of man himself and his arboreal terrains of knowledge. I love it. It's like all these people writing on Lovecraft being this ultimate nihilist, and I think he's the most jubilant writer since Nietzsche. Here arises another absence for which Lovecraft is critiqued, a supposed, even likely, aversion to the carnal. But in some ways, he represents bodies and sex in a positive manner. From a feminist perspective, the construction of filiation through unnatural participation describes a liberation of desire between two unlike entities that is not premised on the dominance of a single mode of understanding, which is usually phallo-logocentrism. And I feel a bit similar in terms of practices of chaos magic because it seems to me that money, I call it money shot chaos magic, where, you know, it's results based. That doesn't seem like an unnatural participation. That just seems like acting like, you know, Donald Trump. So that doesn't seem to be anything particularly transcendental about it or particularly unnatural about it. So Erigere, speaking of angelic sex as mucosal, is relevant to Lovecraft's monster heredity. And I just heard Erigere scream in terror. And I quote, "The consequences of such non-fulfillment of the sexual act remain. To take only the most beautiful example, let us consider the angels. These messengers are never immobile, nor do they ever dwell in one single place. As mediators of what has not yet taken place, these angels, therefore, open up the closed nature of the world, identity, action, and history." End quote. It is the affect rather than the structure which differs. Erigere describes this angelic carnality as a writing or expression found in mucus. Mucus connects. It is the sticky, abject, but jubilant viscosity of jouissance, which is premised on lack of demarcation between entities or shared fluidities and on the qualities associated with the unnameability of feminine desire that repudiates logic, singularity, and dominant binary tenets of knowledge and perception. Erigere states, "Nor will I ever see the mucus, that most intimate interior of my flesh, neither the touch of the outside of the skin of my fingers, nor the perception of the inside of these same fingers, but another threshold of the passage from outside to inside, from inside to outside, between outside and inside, between inside and outside," end quote. And mucus is, of course, what traditionally makes up the texture of both female sexual fluid and the monster. It is this aspect of angelic ecstasy, ecstasy, I'm going to call, that is used in physics that makes me interested in angels as catalysts for monster sex. Angels are monsters. I know, I was raised Catholic. I can also hear them all rolling in their graves, all the nuns that taught me. Angels are monsters because both are a passage towards thresholds and both represent thresholds themselves. Angels are made of mucus. As its own kind of animal, the angel is the interstitial species, the half-fallen, the pseudo-celestial, the androgynous. In the inhumanness it catalyzes with and as us, it is the human-made mystical, not because it transcends the animal, but because it refuses the human. And that's what I really like about it, because a lot of post-human theory fetishizes animals or non-human animals, and I think that's rubbish because, you know, we've already fetishized otherness. Let's get over that. And this is where my work on ahuman theory, because I think that mysticism and occult practice can allow us to get out of the human without fetishizing the minoritarian. And so in my sense, I'm reading the angel as an Enochian Grigori, so as the fallen of the Book of Enoch. And what I find fascinating about that is that angels in the Book of Enoch were fallen, so they were demonic. They weren't interested in men. They only went for women. And they were androgynous. So that sexuality itself is also... I also like that the same Grigori that teaches you how to use eyeliner teaches you how to use weapons. I think that's pretty cool. That's my understanding of it. I'm reading in a very perverse way that angels they're fallen. They're seven gyre and that lot. So they both are the encounter and are in human relation themselves. The angel is the messenger of the outside and the message itself, becoming a conduit with us toward nothing evolutionary, so I'm absolutely not talking about the techno-man, nor devolutionary, which is the animal, and I use that as humans would say it. I don't think there's anything devolutionary about animals, but humans would. Oh, okay. But inciting the inhuman through repudiating evolution itself, no genus, no species, no science or time. So in my interpretation, the angel is the encounter with the outside, the becoming with that which through disorientation causes ecstasy. Art, ritual, literature, all concepts inconceivable can act as angels. Becoming inhuman through angelic passage is the indeterminability of love. Perhaps the most famous example of angel as passage is found in Bernini's Ecstasy of St. Teresa. The ecstasy of St. Teresa is interkingdom and inhuman because her body disappears in the fabric And the folds and pleats of Teresa's robe materially resonate with and as the folds and pleats of her ecstasy. So she is living as Baroque expressivity, or she is an affected Baroque expression. Similarly, we must walk around the sculpture and can never experience it through a single plane, although, you know, you can't walk around the sculpture. But what I really love about sculpture is that you can never apprehend it through a single plane. There are curvatures beneath those that we can see, as well as each always having an underside and point of the turn of the pleat, where we can see both its concavity and convexivity, which reminds me of how Lovecraft describes Cthulhu's face. There are those we perceive, but we cannot see because Bernini could not sculpt, but simply because they are not present in stone does not mean that we don't believe in them. The pleats that are not present to us at each singular position are present. Those that are not present are nonetheless affective to us because we presume, so we believe that they are there. Pleats are multiple within themselves and in proximity to each other, and each pleat directly affects the pleat next to it, and thus all the pleats. Her robe is the waves of an ocean and the trailing of smoke. This is a sculpture of desire. All right, let me skip some stuff. Blah, blah, blah. Okay, I'm going to talk really briefly about ecstasy. So this is her ecstasy. And ecstasy, I think the encounter with this sculpture is itself an angel. I think this whole sculpture in its entirety is an angel, because if it's affective, it doesn't represent ecstasy. If you've ever stood in front of it, it freaking causes ecstasy. So what is ecstasy? Ecstasy is experiencing the inhuman in a qualitative way, which is outside of signification, outside of subjectivity, outside of language, but also outside of temporality. So it is a purely spatial moment. Ecstasy is pain, which is multiple, imperceptible, indescribable, voluminous, and annihilative toward joy, rather than ending in death, repetition, or satisfaction. Ecstasy through the inhumanity of art is the infinite, infinitesimal, and incommensurable plethora of pleasure found in loss of self. Ecstasy is a configuration and dissipation of desire, beyond knowledge, desire outside of time and without recognisable other. Ecstasy involves a risk of self. To love art as inhuman is to relinquishing being a being while nonetheless being. And I guess if I had to define magic, I would define it as that. And so here's another slide. Actually, maybe I'll just go through the slides and just talk about them. Here's another slide. So this is Bernini's Santa Biascia del Ludovico. What I like about her is she doesn't need an angel. She's happy all by herself. But as you can see, she also has this, you know, this Baroque ecstasy. And I'm fascinated because I love it when art is able to represent the collapse of all materiality into a single plane of consistency. And so we see that in Biascia de Ludovico. She's clearly in an ecstasy. She's agendered. She's not, like, Lacan didn't even know about this one. He was such an idiot. And the idea of a belief in an unseen and an unseeable, but a nonetheless affective, is why I think that ritual is so important, because we've all had that experience of, you can't, you know, I'm an anti-theist, but you can't believe in magic if you're an anti-theist. And, you know, when you've all probably been in this situation, trying to describe affect and change without describing empirical belief as some kind of dogma. And this is another artist called Beksinski, which you probably know. And what I really like about this is that we get with artists like Beksinski, the actual becomings that are really becoming cosmic on their way to becoming imperceptible that we see in Lovecraft work. So, you know, mammals are weird, cephalopods are weirder, cephalopods you make up yourself are weirder, and then we get these things where you have, or what Lyotard calls the great ephemeral skin, where you get the body is unraveled into a body without organs, but also everything from, like, becoming music, because music is an abstract mathematics, becoming texture, you know, the idea that the inorganic and the organic are able to create connectivities. And then we have some spare. Obviously, you know, the becoming goat, his sort of Baphomet. But then I really liked also the the really frenetic automatic drawings where it's actually simply about becoming movement. So this whole notion of texture, and we've heard today about frenetic texture and vibrations and stuff like that. But what is really interesting about this is this quote from Deleuze and Guattari, I hope you can read it, where they say that philosophers must be sorcerers, that a philosopher that is not a sorcerer has not created anything but is simply reflecting on the world. And so this obsession with reflecting on a world in order to know in order to control, it's all a bit rubbish, really. So I shall go now to my conclusion. I've got four, how can I have four slides left? All right. Irigaray and Lovecraft's Carter share much in the elements constituting this cosmogenic asubjectivity. Feminism celebrates this state, and so the extent to which Lovecraft can be applied to a new age of interpretation through alterity is measured by the extent to which his tales remain horror stories. The reader must ask, horror for whom? Carter's could be a jouissant journey. And it was a new book that just come out on Lovecraft, and I'm the only woman in it, and I'm the only one that doesn't say, oh, it's so terrible that everyone dies and they're not real anymore. Carter's could be a jouissant journey just as easily as it could be a journey toward becoming imperceptible. His gods could be angelic rather than terrifying gods that don't care about poor little men. Yes, there is no sex in Lovecraft, but his oeuvre is fundamentally based on visceral connectivities with the unlike, and in their inevitable realisation of their teratological heredity, his protagonists grapple with their relationship, not with monsters, but with the way they feel about relations themselves. Just as minor literature is a grappling with perception and aperception, in which readers have a choice to lose themselves in the forfeiting of subjectivity for unheard-of becomings, or to conform their subjectivity and dismiss a tale as fictive, ineffective, and pure fantasy, such as Carter and Ward and poignantly The Outsider, choose either to remain outsiders or succumb to the self-non-self of becoming with monsters, gods, and ultimately, in ecosophical theory, the cosmos. Remember, the story of The Outsider is the story of all minority human subjects and how they live already, women included. When we reach the point where we realise that, because of our gender, race or other differences, the monster is in the mirror and the dominant white male face is neither reflection nor aspiration, but the most mythological subject of all. No sex in Lovecraft. However, lots of production without reproduction. Lovecraft's tales of horror for the reader open to, perhaps because already becoming outsider, as perverse love stories. Michel Serres states, love is a chimera, the leftovers of the split up parts, just like the gods, protagonists, monsters and angels of his tales. This is an artist called Bracha Edinger, and this series of paintings, I can flip through them during question time, is called Eurydice. And of course, what is beautiful about them is that they're non-representational, and Eurydice refused to try and see in the dark, and that's why he lost... Orpheus refused to try and see in the dark, and that's why he lost Eurydice, because he only would look at her as an illuminated being rather than learn a different way to look. So, and this is a nice quote from Guattari to end on. Thank you.
Patricia, thank you very, very much indeed. I think the thing that stood out for me most was something you said in the end, like about Lovecraft, is horror for whom? Mm. And you know, could this not? We could have a reading in which it's incredibly jouissant, and that connectivity and the mucosity and those kinds of interaction could be seen as something incredibly desirable, not something horrible. And I'm going to take the liberty of asking the first question, and just keep it brief, and because I want to open up for other people, is I'm very, very aware there have been loads and loads of Cthulhu rituals ever since, you know, the occult revival got going. And so are those, is that perhaps falling in love? You know, is that Lovecraft, is, you know, is are Cthulhu rituals, you know, is that the love story?
We've always had this impasse. Because if you're not doing rituals for results, then you are falling in love. But, and I even feel the same way about, you know, when I started reading people like Eliphas Levi and stuff, and I was always fascinated about, you know, magic is all about invoking the other, controlling the other, banishing the other. And I always had a little bit of an icky feeling about that. I always thought that, you know, an encounter with an absolute other, which back then I didn't realise was a fabulated other, but the point is the risk. The point is that you enter into a becoming because the other is so unlike any capacity for you to recognise it that you yourself are launched on another. So I think that actually, I don't want to bifurcate it, but I think I've met chaos magicians who are very results-based, who like to affirm their subjectivity by doing rituals and then returning to order, but then, I don't know, getting rich in the process or getting women or getting whatever they think they want. But I've also met people that are much more interested in loss of self, and I think that a lot of Spare's stuff on the death posture, you know, the idea that death and dying to yourself actually brings you alive to unnatural participations with the world. And I think for an ecosophical aesthetics, for a cosmic ethics, that really we have to be, and I'm not going to call it a sacrifice because the sacrifice overvalues the sacrifice. Mm. I think instead of saying let's all become white hetero men so that we can have equal rights, we all need to start divesting ourselves of our association of certain human signifying systems with power and start saying that there is an ecstasy to be found in the unnatural participation of losing power in order to be affected so that you are given the gift by the other to have to think in novel and creative ways outside of your comfort zone. Okay, so that was the right answer.
That's awesome. Okay. I'm going to come down because we've got time, because we made time for questions from you, but somebody else has one of those. Okay, great.
Cavan, are you going to run around?
Do you want me to run around?
Yeah, Cavan's going to run around. Who'd like to have a question from you guys? Cavan's not going to run around for nothing.
Was that answer too good? Is that the problem?
Is it wine time?
I know you are predominantly an academic. Have you ever written any of your own Lovecraftian-influenced fiction?
Actually, I have a confession. When I did my undergraduate, when I was, I was 19, I wrote ancient Greek-inspired necrophilia fiction. It wasn't Lovecraft. It was very classics. It was very, very classics-driven. And it's been published. And when I read it, I think, what a disturbed little girl you were. Yeah, sorry. But I haven't written fiction since I was about 19, no.
Please thank you all, and please join me in thanking Patricia MacCormack.